This week, meet the UMKC professor who's just won the Pulitzer Prize for music.
America Now and Here starts a national journey using art to jumpstart meaningful dialogue.
Also this week, we tackle childhood obesity.
And continue our series on the National World War I Museum as we explore that war through the words and mementos of those who fought in it.
Principal funding for the local show provided by Frederick and Louise Hartwig Family Fund, Kaufman Foundation, Francis Family Foundation, Toy and Miniature Museum of Kansas City, Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, Sprint Foundation, Hall Family Foundation, Hallmark Cards Incorporated, Muriel McBrien Kaufman Foundation, and KCPT supporters like you. Thank you.
Randy Mason.
And I'm Nick Haynes, and welcome to The Local Show.
You may have read recently how a UMKC professor just won the Pulitzer Prize for music.
The big-time honor bestowed on Zhou Long for composing the music to the opera Madame Whitesnake, which is getting critical acclaim from Boston to Beijing.
I got a chance to chat with him. But first, here's an excerpt from the work that's getting him all this attention.
The story is 1,000 years old, but this is the first time composed into a Western opera tradition, but sung in English. I grew up from an artistic family. My mother was a teacher, vocal teacher, and my father is a fine art artist, like oil painting. But during the Cultural Revolution, I stopped my musical training and sent to the State Farm in the northeast of China. I drove a tractor for 5 years, grow beans and wheat. After the Cultural Revolution, I heard the news from the radio, the university system resumed. So I was very excited and rushed back to Beijing and take the exam and admitted into the first class, composition class, at the Central Conservatory in Beijing.
Well, you were a piano playing kid, right?
Yes, I started at 5, but I gave up at 7. I'm not a good pianist, but I brought my accordion with me to the farm. You know, it's a very harsh life there. Mm. We live in a tent in the very cold weather, and we build our own house.
I'm wondering, does working in Kansas City, has that inspired any of this?
I would say in Kansas, it's a very nice environment as a composer. It's quiet, mid-sized city, you have everything. And the school have been very supportive. I have a fairly amount of teaching load, and then I got one semester sabbatical leave to support concentrate on this opera.
One opera and one Pulitzer. It's just that easy. Everybody should just write an opera, and it falls into place, because it somehow doesn't seem like, it seems like it's pretty amazing.
Yes, as my knowledge, this is the only second opera win the Pulitzer in the history. The first one in 62, and this is the second one. It's not that easy, but sounds like very easy. This is my first opera, and boom, you get a Pulitzer. I was surprised, but I'm very proud to win this. I'm very optimistic and very hopeful. The lyrical opera, the Kansas City Symphony, and the UMKC Conservatory could all work together to put this opera on stage at the new Kaufman Center.
It seems like that would be the perfect way for all this to play out, wouldn't it?
Yes, I hope.
All right. Well, it's been great to have Zhou Long with us here on The Local Show.
Thank you very much.
Next on The Local Show, we continue our ongoing series on the National World War I Museum at Liberty Memorial. Among its holdings are artifacts and memorabilia from the soldiers who fought in the Great War, soldiers from across the globe. That's the subject of this installment of the series we call A Place to Remember.
From 1914 to 1919, the world was at war. 36 countries from six continents sent more than 70 million military personnel into worldwide conflict. It's staggering, especially when you consider that each of those people had a story of their own. Suddenly, the differences between nationalities, foreign policies, and inherent beliefs blur with the commonality of being human. At war's end, many of them returned to their countries scarred and wounded. Many fell, never to return home. Here are five brief stories of men from all over the world who participated in the Great War. Their photos and memorabilia are found here at the National World War I Museum at Liberty Memorial. Tensions between Serbia and Austria-Hungary had been escalating for many years, until in 1914, a Bosnian Serb nationalist assassinated the heir to the throne of Austria-Hungary, sparking a declaration of war. Allies quickly chose sides, Russia with Serbia, Germany with Austria-Hungary. Two of the 8 million people who served in the Austro-Hungarian army were Ferdinand Bauer and his brother Wenceslaus. They found themselves in a 19th century army, trying to prepare for a modern war. Men, machines, and materials were hard to come by. Austria-Hungary fought on three fronts: in the Balkans against Serbia and Romania, against the Allies on the Italian front, and against Russia on the Eastern Front. One Austrian wrote from the Eastern Front,
"The Russians had lured us into a trap. I had actually set eyes on the Russian machine guns before I felt a dull blow on my temple. The sun and the moon were both shining at once, and my head ached like mad. And all that yelling around me and the moaning of the wounded, which seemed to fill the whole forest. Then I became absorbed by the fact that I couldn't control the cavalry boot with the leg in it, which was moving too far, although it belonged to me."
By war's end, along with the Austro-Hungarian Empire, over 1 million citizens lay dead. After the invasion of Serbia, the German army smashed through Belgium and Luxembourg on its way to France. Sergeant Frederick Louis Rousset was in combat those first days as a part of the Chasseurs Alpins, an elite mountain infantry in the French army. Nicknamed the Blue Devils, they halted the German march on Paris, holding them at bay on the Western Front. Settled into trenches along stationary lines, the combatants exchanged machine gun and artillery fire across the area called No Man's Land. One Chasseurs Alpins wrote,
"At the beginning of the war, the Germans had more of them than what we had. And every time a machine gun opened fire in our sector, my men would listen carefully. And when someone said, 'It's the coffee mill,' his remark would send a tingle down our spines. I know nothing more depressing in the midst of battle than the steady tack, tack, tack of that deadly weapon. There appears to be nothing material to its working. It seems to be dominated and directed by some powerful, scheming spirit of destruction."
During the war, Sergeant Rousset received the Croix de Guerre for injuries sustained while taking out a German machine gun. But the dreaded weapon eventually took his life. And in 1916, he was posthumously awarded the Ordre National de Légion d'Honneur. In 1916, over 2.5 million men and women had volunteered for the British Army. By war's end, 703,000 of them had been killed. Many were buried in temporary graves in foreign fields. Second Lieutenant Henry Jeffson Hillary of the British Royal Field Artillery was killed and buried in France. The chaplain from the artillery wrote Hillary's widow,
"I visited your husband's grave and I was very glad to see the large white cross with an inscription which the 92nd Battery had erected over it. From the very first, your husband was in the highest degree liked and respected by us all. He will not be forgotten here and will be greatly missed.
Before 1915, the process of identifying and burying bodies, then marking graves, was haphazard and often left to the individual units. In 1916, the Imperial War Graves Commission was established to provide new orders on how to bury soldiers.
We were to take from their pockets paybooks and personal effects such as money, watches, rings, photos, letters, and so on. One identification disc had also to be removed, the other being left on the body. Boots were supposed to be removed if possible, as salvage was the order of the day. A small white bag was provided for each man's effects, the neck of which was to be securely tied and his identity disc attached thereto. It was a gruesome job.
Wooden grave markers were planted to identify the place of the fallen. After the war, the temporary burial sites were converted into more garden-like cemeteries with permanent headstones. When 2nd Lieutenant Hillary was laid to rest in France, his wooden marker was sent home to his widow. Following in the footsteps of his father, Gerd Willy Norman served as an officer in the German Naval Corps. At the start of the war, his regiment became a land-based Marine Corps stationed in Flanders, which entered Belgium in September 1914 and days later laid siege to Antwerp. Near the end of the war, while the Treaty of Versailles was being crafted, Norman served as an officer aboard the SMS Prinzregent Luitpold of the German fleet. The Luitpold was one of 74 ships interned at Scapa Flow in Scotland. The skeleton crew remaining on the ships lived in poor conditions. One sailor wrote,
"It is always the same comrades around you, always the same ships around you, always the same view of the land."
After the official surrender, and to prevent the British from seizing their fleet, the German commander allegedly ordered all 74 ships scuttled to the depths of Scapa Flow. Norman was taken prisoner and held at a British POW camp until he was repatriated to Germany. Years later, in 1940, he fled Nazi Germany and immigrated to the United States. In 1917, the U.S. entered the war. Vernon Coffey from Kansas City was one of nearly 368,000 African Americans called under the 1917 Selective Services Draft. He trained at Camp Funston, Kansas, then left for France, eventually ending up with the 806th Pioneer Infantry. Coffey's engineering regiment was stationed on the Metz and Bayeville fronts when they got orders to move up.
We were in the third line trenches, and I must say that we enjoyed some shocks from old Fritz's big guns. We stayed up near Limy until the armistice was signed.
In spite of segregation, in his unit as well as at home in the U.S., Sergeant Coffey was proud of his participation in the Great War.
We were awarded a silver band, which was to bear the names of the Argonne and Meuse offensive on it. It was to be placed on the pike of the regimental colors, and we were also awarded a ribbon to be placed on our flag. This credit was given by the commanding chief of the American Expeditionary Forces, who was General Pershing.
When Sergeant Coffey returned in 1919, he became an attorney and later a preacher for the first AME church in Kansas City, Kansas.
These are only five stories from the Great War. Today you can find hundreds, if not thousands, of stories like these at the National World War I Museum at Liberty Memorial.
In 2008, KCPT launched a year-long series called Generation XL, focused on slimming down the fast-expanding waistlines of our kids and making them more physically active. Did we solve the childhood obesity problem? No, but we certainly sparked a lot of conversation and focus among school administrators, parents, and some area health and civic organizations. As part of an ongoing partnership with Blue Cross Blue Shield of Kansas City, we continue to spotlight programs and success stories that are trying to move the needle on this issue. Next on The Local Show, a new youth obesity prevention program called Healthy You.
The Junior League of Kansas City, Missouri has been an agent of profound change since 1914. By utilizing an army of female member volunteers, they have been able to drastically improve the quality of life for generations in the metro area. This year, the league, in partnership with Harvesters, was proud to shift their focus to youth obesity prevention.
The Junior League launched the Healthy You program as the kickoff of our impact area of children's nutrition, fitness, and obesity prevention, and it will go for 5 years. We were excited to bring Healthy You to the University Academy community for its students and faculty as a way to layer fitness, nutrition, and other health-related programming all together.
When you pick a community partner to work with, I think there's lots of different opportunities out there. University Academy had the administration that was on board with making changes in the school, as well as there's a high instance of kids that qualify for free and reduced lunch. And we also wanted to make a distinct impact with a specific population, and they were really willing to come on board and partner with us.
I think we've had some small initiatives, but nothing like what this partnership has brought to us. Over 80% of our students at University Academy qualify for free and reduced lunch, and a fair number of those students within that population are actually food insecure, which means that they're not getting a lot of food at home. And so over the weekend, for example, when they're not able to eat breakfast and lunch at school, they're not getting a lot of nutrition.
The one thing we realized right off the bat was you cannot focus on nutrition or fitness or the eventual goal of obesity prevention if students aren't getting the nutrition they needed. So we found the Harvesters Back Snack program that they have got running all over the city with different organizations and different schools. Weekly, we have volunteers here at Junior League headquarters packing backpacks, getting extra materials, whether it be a note to the students or whether it be throwing gloves in the bag during the winter or jump ropes loaded up and prepared to be delivered to the school.
From what I hear, the kids get really excited when the teachers come down the hallways with the bags of food. So, I mean, that's what I'm here for, because I know kids are, gonna have some food this weekend. It makes me feel good.
I feel like University Academy won the lottery. I mean, this is such a wonderful program. Teachers are thrilled because kids come in on Monday morning ready to learn.
Before, my snacks were candy and cookies. Now there are cereal, 2% milk, chocolate milk, apple or grape juice, healthy snack bars, and pudding.
To really make a difference in these students' lives, we not only have to do a great job in the classroom, but we've got to surround them with programming and other components that really will help them achieve at the highest levels. And our kids can absolutely achieve at the highest levels.
The other component of programming that we started in the very first year was also called our family dinners. And so we take about 10 to 20 families a semester, and it's a 6-week curriculum. There are activities for the kids in the curriculum as well as activities for the parents. They learn about healthy meal preparation. They share a healthy meal.
And at the end of this lesson, they actually get a 20-pound bag of food to take home with the ingredients of the items they just learned to cook and to supplement any food that they might need for the week.
The Healthy You program has benefited our family and basically just letting us know that how we're raising our family, we're on the right track. There are more things we could do, probably to induce more fruits and vegetables, probably for a dessert versus cakes or cookies or whatever, but try to have more fluids as far as more water and juice and milk versus just the sugary beverages that, of course, kids like to drink anyway. But it's just little things like that, we do watch out more for than we did before.
The Healthy You program will expand throughout the 5-year commitment with the addition of a community garden, an indoor and outdoor walking track, and the expansion of the Back Snack program into the summer. In addition, the program will extend into middle school, teaching preteens to make meals on less than a dollar, as well as other health initiatives. But the Junior League's community impact doesn't stop there. Their positive reach can be felt throughout the community,
We have a partnership with Girls on the Run, which is a physical activity and self-esteem type of club for girls. And we have a walking club with Ozanam. We have worked with the National Sports Center for the Disabled. We also will start a new partnership with Operation Breakthrough. They've been a long-standing partner of ours, but they would like us to do a family dinner type of program with their parents and kids as well. One of the things the Junior League is really good at is starting programs, especially with the manpower we bring to the table, and then handing them back to the community. It's easy for us to come in because we have volunteers who are trained. We're ready to spend that time in an organization and build up the reserves of that organization so they can then take on the project.
It's one of the reasons why I joined the Junior League of Kansas City, Missouri. It's because it brings together committed women that are in the community that want to make a difference. And you know, so often you sit back and you watch the news or you read the paper and you see about all these needs that are in the community, and you want to do something. The Junior League breaks it down. It makes it easy for the ladies to be a part of the solution.
I'm liking it. I really do.
And finally on this week's local show, we head into the art world. At this month's First Friday, the Lidi Volkas Gallery and several other spaces in the Crossroads Art District opened their doors to a brand new exhibit with grand intentions and a national scope. As Randy Mason discovered, the arrival of America now and here has been years in the making.
Yesterday we had a day of placement, and today this is actually the first day of installing art. And much like everything that we've had happen here in Kansas City, we've encountered nothing but the best of the best.
It was our goal to come into Kansas City and to start a conversation in Kansas City, or inspire a conversation, not sort of infiltrate a place, but really learn from the community itself. These are kind of iconic artists, everyone from Ed Ruscha to Chuck Close to Sally Mann to Eric Fischel, whose piece is incredibly moving to me. These are my heroes.
This moment is a moment of confusion for us nationally. And so the time is right to examine precisely who it is we are, what we believe in, what our values are.
Eric Fischel, the man who dreamed all this up, admits that as a painter and sculptor, he's used to seeing his ideas come to fruition relatively quickly. America Now and Here, he says, has taught him patience. From concept to its debut in the Crossroads, the process has taken a full 4 years.
This is not about art. This is about coming someplace to use art, to think and feel about something else that is shared by the country.
And it kind of sounds like a Judy Garland movie after a while. You know, the filmmaker said, well, we want to play, and the playwright said, well, we want to act. And, you know, it grew to 150 great artists.
It was a crapshoot. You know, it could have come back and it could have been like just more yelling and screaming, you know, pictures yelling and screaming at you, something cynical. And I was just so happy to see what did come back, because it was so reasoned, so beautiful. There's some, you know, incredibly sensitive and tender stuff. There's light things. And they're just all different ways of kind of looking at this thing we call America.
Another element that separates this show from most is the way that works by those heavy hitters hang literally side by side with pieces by local artists. David Ford curated the visual arts, while other Kansas Cityans like Ben Mead, Cynthia Levin, and Glenn North did the same for poetry, music, and film, launching activities throughout the area.
We're taking over the neighborhood in a great way. We have great partners here. We have bike rides around the city. We have a program where scientists and magicians are going to be invited to play. We have all kinds of brown bag lunches.
Don't leave, let it drip fast, pass fast, halls infinitely.
I think that you have an incredible arts community here. The infrastructure of Kansas City really supports the arts. There's incredibly talented people here. I can't look at a piece and say, oh, that came from Kansas City, not from, you know, one of our core artists in America Now and Here.
But with a whole nation to choose from, why start in Kansas City? Well, for one thing, there's our legacy of so many trails passing through. Officials' dream is that America Now and Here will someday roll down the road to deliver its experience via specially constructed transformer-type trucks like these.
You know, there's such a great tradition of trucks pulling into town, unfurling these circuses, these carnivals, these medicine shows.
Of course, building that fleet is a costly proposition. So this year's limited edition KC, Chicago, and Milwaukee run has been designed in large part to work out the kinks and prime the pump of philanthropic giving.
We're hoping to use the exposure as a way of getting people to see how real the show is, what its programs are, how it works, and then fall of 2012 begin to do a truck tour with it. And what we're doing is a journey that we're beginning. We have no idea what we're going to discover out there. It just begins here. We'll see.
America Now and Here runs through May 28th with numerous events, including bike rides, plays, drawing classes, and more. You can get the details at our website, thelocalshow.org. I'm Nick Haynes. We'll see you next time on The Local Show.
Principal funding for The Local Show provided by Frederick and Louise Hartwig Family Fund, Kauffman Foundation, Francis Family Foundation, Toy and Miniature Museum of Kansas City, Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, Sprint Foundation, Hall Family Foundation, Hallmark Cards Incorporated, Muriel McBrien Kauffman Foundation, and KCPT supporters like you. Thank you.